Well, good morning. It's so good to welcome you here this morning. Looking forward to seeing you face to face. But we don't have to be face to face to give God glory. It's going to be an awesome morning. I guarantee it. You're awesome, Lord.
We're reaching out to welcome you, God. Fill this place again with your song. Flood our thoughts with wonder and awe. Give us a great glimpse of a never-changing God. To all we want and all we need is found in you, found in you. Jesus, every victory is found in you, found in you. Oh, 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 oh. Open wide our hearts now to down to your love, that we would see like never before. Give us a great glimpse of never-changing God. Till all we want and all we need is found in you.
What an amazing truth that we are found in Jesus, and what that means for us and the victory we have in Christ is just so encouraging to us as a people and as a followers of Christ, that our future is secure in Him, and that's just an amazing declaration. So, well, good morning and welcome to you all, wherever you are, wherever you're watching from. I'm so glad that you could join us. My name is Gary Buck. I'm the lead pastor here at Hopewell. And if this is the first time that you've joined with us, we invite you to go to our website. It's hopewellchurch.org/guest. And just take a second and fill that out for us. It would help us get to know you a little bit better. And we would love to connect with you in that way. And also, as always, if you have any prayer needs, anything going on in your own personal life that you would like us as a church to be praying for you about, we have a team of people who are praying every day and every week for the people of our church and beyond. You can send those requests to us at prayer@hopewellchurch.org. So please take advantage of that. Well, if you haven't already heard, this is the last Sunday that we are doing a streaming-only service praise God. And this coming week is when we begin our in-person services. So just if, in case you haven't heard, very quickly here, Thursday night is our first service at 6:30. That's the one that we are targeting specifically for people who feel like they're in the at-risk group. And that includes elderly people, people who have compromised immune systems. That also includes children in those groups as well. So if you're a family with children in that at-risk group, you're welcome to attend the Thursday night service as well. But we are asking that that other families with children, who have children not in the at-risk group, attend our Sunday morning services. So Sunday morning, next Sunday, we have two service options at 9 o'clock a.m. and 11 o'clock a.m. And so at the Thursday night service, we're asking that masks be worn the whole time. What we're doing for the Sunday morning service is that we're recommending that masks be worn just simply when you enter the church doors. And then once you get to your seats in the sanctuary, you can take them off and just enjoy worshiping and listening to the sermon without the masks on. So, but we're just hoping all this is very temporary. We're going to kind of watch how things are going. We're talking to experts in the field and our local authorities and just kind of figure out what's the best course of action here. And we hope to lift some of these restrictions as soon as possible. Also, in case you missed it, we released a tour guide video. So you can kind of know what to expect when you come to church this week, what it's going to look like, how it's going to work. It's on our YouTube channel, the Hopewell Church Elverson YouTube channel. So you can head over there and watch that there. Also, we're going to be streaming that tour guide video after our children's program this morning. If you just want to hang on and just watch it there as well, you can see that. And I think that would be really helpful for a lot of you, just to kind of see what it's going to look like. The big thing, though, that we haven't really announced very much yet is that we need from all of you is help with is that we're asking that you all use something called Sign Up Genius to sign up for which service you want to attend. This isn't just to reserve a spot. What we're asking you to do is there's a link on our church website on our front page. You can go there and sign up today. But what we're asking you to do, though, is not just sign up. Don't just go there and say, okay, that's the service I want to go to. Do us a favor, please. Look at how many people are already signed up for a service. You can see that in the right-hand column of the website, and you'll see how many people are already signed up. And if it doesn't matter to you, please try to attend the one that has less people attending. That will really help us maintain the standards we need to keep in this room for maximum occupancy. The one legal thing that we really do have to follow is maximum occupancy rules for our size building. At least that's the way it works here in Pennsylvania. So we can't exceed 50% maximum occupancy. So please do us a favor when you sign up. Please, before you sign up, look and see which service is being more attended. And again, if it really doesn't matter to you, please try to help us out by kind of spreading out the numbers amongst the services. So thank you all, and please take advantage of that Sign Up Genius option. Also, just want to make sure you're all aware that we are working on, there's a little bit of construction happening in our sanctuary. As many of you know, we're moving our soundboard and actually moving some computer systems. So the soundboard will be bigger, and it'll be more in the back center of the sanctuary when you arrive. That'll really help us get a better mix. That's where the soundboard should be. And it will help us get a more even spread. And also, the carpet may or may not be in place yet, so you might see some slits or some duct tape in carpet in the old carpet as you arrive, but we should have our new carpet in here very soon, so just bear with us as we are working through that a little bit. Also want to remind you that I will be hanging out in the cafe, the digital cafe, afterwards. And if you want to join me just to talk, if you have any questions about opening up church or anything I said during the service today, we'd love to chat with you there, so please head on to that link. It's also on our church website. All right, just a special thanks to all of you for your faithful giving week after week, their tithes and offerings. Thank you so much. I really just pray that God would bless you and be faithful to his promises to bless you, what we see in his word, for your faithful and joyful giving. And as always, there's different ways that you can give online. You can give through our church website, hopewellchurch.org. You can do so through our church app. If you don't have our app, it's just search for Hopewell Elverson in your app store. And there are many other places that you can look as well. You can also text us your giving as well, and you can also send us a check in the mail, just if you like to send it the old-fashioned way. So thank you. And before we pray, I also just wanted to just bring special attention to what's going on in our nation in regards to the George Floyd death this past week. I know we've seen a lot of protests, and some of the protests have turned to riots, and I know people personally who have been affected by this. And some of the riots, and of course, we as a people and as a church, We want to be a shining light, an example to the world. We pray that the protests, we want to pray that the protests can remain peaceful, and we want to pray against the infectious disease of racism in our nation. Really, if you think about it, racism is a direct attack on God. Because every person, every single person of every single race is divinely created by God. They are created with the image of God. And so it is our job as a people of God to defend every person of every race, no matter what race you are. And so that is our job. It is our right. It is our, God commands us to do this. You know, the scriptures say in Isaiah 61, God says, I love justice. God is a God of justice. And if he loves justice, we must love what God loves. And so it's, I just wanted to stir the heart of God, and through us that our hearts will be stirred as well, as we pray and intercede on behalf of our nation. So just join me in prayer as we pray that we would be a people of truth and love. Let's pray. Father, we thank you so much for your faithfulness. We thank you that you are a God of justice. You are a God of love and truth. And Lord, right now, we as a people, we stand against this attitude, this perception, this mindset, this worldview of racism that has infected so many, not just in our nation, but around the world. And it's always been there. It is something that has to do with our fallen nature, to look down on people just because they are of a different ethnic group. And so, Lord, I just pray right now that you would bring about peaceful resolutions, Lord, to the understandable outrage that is happening in our nation over not just this one death, but many. And Lord, I just pray that you would just break down the lies of racism that has a hold on the hearts of so many. And Lord, even if it's in us, Lord, I just pray that you would completely expose it and eradicate it right now in Jesus' name. And that we as a church will be bringers of love, of peace. And we would be bringers of truth. That we would be people of justice. Because you love justice. Thank you, Lord. And Lord, right now I also pray and thank you for the tithes and offerings that are given this week. Lord, I thank you so much for every person who has given, and I just pray you would bless them and that you would continue to take these tithes and offerings, that they would be used to further your kingdom work through Hopewell here. And Lord, we look forward to meeting together in person this week, and I pray that you would bless those services as well and prepare our hearts just to being together. We thank you for that, God. We thank you for the opportunity that you have called us to meet together. What Paul says is that Paul, the Apostle Paul said, don't stop meeting as some are in the habit of doing. And so this is a wonderful opportunity for us, God, to just gather together to encourage each other in the faith. Thank you so much for creating the church. And we bless you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Well, over the last number of months, the world has certainly changed. It's been difficult. There has even been grieving for many of us. I know many of the senior class members have been grieving. Parents of people in the senior class have been grieving that their children didn't get to have a graduation ceremony. Children lost sports seasons. They lost musicals, field trips, vacations. I know many of us have had big plans this summer, things we wanted to do, and things just got altered. And there has been grieving. It's been a hard process for many of us. But I've also heard from many people in our church body and beyond that have said to me how much good has come out of this too, and how much God has changed them during this time. And it's been hard, but you know what? God doesn't change us with a refining rainbow. God doesn't change us with refining glitter shower. God changes us with his refining fire. And that the scriptures say that God is a consuming fire. So how do we change? If you really think about it, 2 Corinthians 3:18, Paul says this. He says, so all of us who have had that veil removed can see and reflect the glory of the Lord, and the Lord, who is the Spirit, makes us more and more like him as we are changed into his glorious image. So every day we are transformed into the image of Jesus Christ. But the source of that change is not something we drum up on ourselves. It's the Spirit of God. It is his Holy Spirit. And look at this, 1 Corinthians 2, 9 to 10 and verse 16. Paul says, "But as it is written, what no eye has seen, no ear has heard, and no human heart has conceived, God has prepared these things for those who love him. Now God has revealed these things to us by the Spirit, his Holy Spirit, since the Spirit searches everything, even the depths of God. For who has known the Lord's mind that he may instruct him? But we have the mind of Christ." So our goal is to be people who have the mind of Christ, to be changed, to be like him. But this does not happen unless it happens through the Holy Spirit. Someone else can read these same scriptures and nothing happens. Nothing changes because they don't have the Holy Spirit. If we want to change, we must be a people who are desperate for God's Spirit. That's it. Today is Pentecost Sunday. And so we remember on this day that the Holy Spirit came and changed the world. He changed the disciples, his disciples that were hiding in an upper room. And their Holy Spirit came and they were changed forever. And then they couldn't help it. They had to share the gospel. And Peter preaches in front of thousands of people. And Peter, who was hiding before and denying Jesus, now has the Holy Spirit empowering him and he's changed. And so again, I say it, if we want to change, we must be a people who are desperate for God's Spirit. So are you desperate for God's Spirit? Well, you've heard enough from me these last number of weeks, so what I wanted to do today is something special. I really wanted to ask some people from our church to share with you all about how God has been changing them during this time, and it's been a process, but they're going to share how God has changed them through His Spirit, through His Word, and through this difficult time, because God is on the move. So we have three people who are going to share. And so first one I'll introduce is Chris McCarty. He's going to share a little bit of his story about how God's been working in his heart. So Chris, come on up.
Well, good morning, Hopewell. My name is Chris McCarty. I know a lot of people who are probably watching this, but for those who don't know, my family and I sit down here. We've been coming for about 5 years. It was just my wife and I when we started coming here. And since then, we've had three beautiful children, Cora, Declan, and Alistair. So my wife, Natalie, and I have been very blessed over this time. So I wanted to thank them for all of their patience and their support over this time. And I also want to thank all of our pastors. They've done an amazing job over these past several months. I am very glad that I have not had to make the decisions and do the different things that they've had to go through over these past couple months. So I'd probably say that I see the past few months in a slightly different perspective than most. I'm blessed to be a physician, and as a physician, I've had the privilege of studying pandemics and infectious disease outbreaks. I've been doing this since college and medical school, and I've actually found it fascinating from a public health stance, at least, or epidemiology. But with that said, I enjoy being a family physician, where the most common hazards I see would be the common cold or flu. Then enter COVID-19. Like many of us, I had questions of, what would this mean for me? My biggest question would be, where would I be working? What would I be doing? Would I be continuing to work in my office? Or would I be moved to an evaluation site, or an urgent care, or the emergency department, or even starting to treat severely sick patients in the hospital, which is something I haven't done in years. The first few weeks were actually very, very stressful, even though our office was super slow. We were trying to transition how we do our work to this program. I'm not sure if anyone's heard of it. It's called Zoom. But much of what I was doing has been changed. In April, I received a call that let me know that I would actually be transitioning out of my office and be working at our COVID evaluation tent outside of our emergency department at the hospital. While I felt a peace about this, I was quite apprehensive. You see, I like having control of my work situation. I consistently work the same hours in a consistent office and consistently with the same people. Now I was being asked to go to a new place with new procedures and a whole new groups of people. Also, I was going to be working with a virus that, even for someone my age, can have serious health consequences. I also felt like I was kind of abandoning my patients, whom I truly enjoy working with. I also went from working, you know, typical business hours to mostly nights and weekends at first, which was really tough on my family. You know, the first time I went to work in the evening or in the afternoon instead of in the morning, and my daughter knew that I wasn't going to be home for bedtime, she cried, which was really, really tough. God let me know I had a choice, though. I could embrace the difficulties or wallow in the disappointment that I was being chosen to do this work while many others in my same position were actually starting to work less hours and mostly from home. So I started reading from the book of James. Now, this is a book of the Bible that's been very encouraging and inspiring to me in the past and other times that I've gone through other difficult situations in my life. So in chapter 1 of James, verses 2 through 4, he says, "Consider it great joy, my brothers and sisters, whenever you experience various trials, because you know that the testing of your faith produces endurance. And in the, let endurance have its full effect, so that you may be mature, complete, lacking nothing." Which, this immediately reminded me of one of my favorite verses from Romans. This is Romans 3, verses 3 through 5, and it's, "And not only that, but we also boast in our afflictions, because we know that affliction produces endurance. Endurance produces proven character, and proven character produces hope. This hope will not disappoint us, because God's love has been poured out in our hearts through the Holy Spirit who was given to us." So with God's help, I decided to embrace my difficulties and serve Jesus the best I can wherever I was through the power of the Holy Spirit. I knew that this would be to work hard and to try to encourage others. See, this pandemic has created a void that needs to be filled with encouragement more than ever before. I knew that this was to start with my coworkers. Even though I probably wasn't going to be in my office at that point for another 6 to 8 weeks, I knew I had to start by encouraging them. See, our organization is not a Christian organization, but in times like this, you can get away with using scripture in things like you typically wouldn't be able to. So I used the previous verses we talked about here in an email to try to, you know, give encouragement and hope during this time. I also realized that my position, which involves me, you know, seeing patients early on in the disease course, would allow me to be able to step in and pray for healing and blessing for people who might not have anyone else praying for them. You know, while examining people, I would, you know, even as I'm touching them, be able to, you know, quietly pray for them. Now, before anyone says anything about social distancing, remember, I'm like in gear head to toe, so I can kind of push those boundaries a little bit. It's hard to know how to act during a pandemic. This is my first. So it's kind of an odd thing with these stay-at-home orders and not being able to go do what we typically want to do. I don't know about you, but I kind of found myself wanting to do things I typically wouldn't want to do just because I couldn't do them. I even thought to myself, oh, it'd be fun to go to TJ Maxx with my wife. That's like a never-ending affair. So I thought it would be good to learn from someone much wiser than me. And who would be better than the Apostle Paul? See, Paul had been in prison on several occasions, and much of the New Testament was actually written by Paul while in imprisonment. So many scholars also believe that his letters, while written in Rome, were written while under house arrest. A stay-at-home order. So I don't want to draw too many comparisons to me working in the emergency room tent and stay-at-home orders to, you know, Paul's imprisonment in Rome. I don't know if I mentioned this, but this like tent's kind of like climate controlled, and there's people constantly bringing free food. So thank you, everyone. Thank you, Twin Valley Coffee, for free coffee. So to get a better look at Paul's, how Paul handled his restrictions, I wanted to look at the book of Philippians. I know it's a book we recently studied. The book was written while he was imprisoned in Rome around AD 60 to 62. So one of the first things we notice is that Paul, he sees this as an opportunity to advance the gospel, as if it's a good thing. So in Philippians chapter 1, verses 12 through 14, Paul says, "Now I want you to know, brothers and sisters, that what has happened to me has actually advanced the gospel, so that it has become known throughout the whole imperial guard to everyone else that my imprisonment is because I am in Christ." He continues from there by saying that I should adopt the same attitude and nature as Jesus Christ. "With grace and humility, I should strive to look to the interest of others with a united spirit of love. In an environment of dissension, I need to not complain or to look to protect myself, but be above it as Christ was, my perfect example. So a few other verses that were really powerful to me would be in Philippians 2, verses 14 through 16, he says, do everything without grumbling and arguing, so that you may be blameless and pure, children of God, who are faultless in a crooked and perverse generation, among whom you shine like stars in the world, by holding firm to the word of life. And then, probably one of the most famous verses in the Bible, Philippians 4, verses 11 through 12, I learned to be content in whatever circumstances I find myself. I know how to make do with little, and I know how to make do with a lot. In any and all circumstances, I've learned that the secret of being content, whether well-fed or hungry, whether in abundance or in need, I am able to do all things through him who strengthens me. Now, this is coming from a man in prison. I have a hard time not grumbling when my Bluetooth speaker doesn't connect to my phone fast enough. Now, I know Paul didn't have an iPhone, but I bet if he did, he would be constantly using it to just tell the world about Jesus. So practically, God has encouraged me to be more like Paul and to allow the Holy Spirit to transform me and to be more intentional about doing the following. Spending more time reading my Bible and praying, because this is the only way to know truth. Discussing God's awesomeness with my family. Giving an encouraging word in person, email, or text. Being more generous with giving. Playing practical jokes on Pastor Kobe's voicemail. Sorry, Nature. And asking God for and looking for opportunities to be encouraging every day. So, thank you, God, for grace, because I have been far from perfect. Just the other day, I forgot to call my father-in-law. It was his birthday. Now, I eventually remembered, 10:30 at night. So, I want to say that my thinking has been transformed through the power of the Holy Spirit during this crisis. So my last encouragement is to everyone listening. While these times have been tough, the church has been thriving, as it always does in times of adversity. I saw of a recent poll that was done in the UK by a polling company called Comrest, and they looked at the percentage of people who were attending church services, religious services, and this is online, of course, but before the pandemic, 6% of people in the UK were regularly attending a service. During this pandemic, that's gone from 6% to 25%. God is moving. Praise him. Thank you.
Good morning. My name is Marion Gaiman. My husband and I, my husband's name is Tim Gaiman. We have been attending here for several years now. And I realized that my transitional verse that I should have used from Chris to me is Proverbs 17:22, a cheerful heart is good medicine. Maybe that's a good transition. So the verse that I just wanted to start with this morning is 1 Thessalonians 5:16-18. And it is, rejoice always, pray continually, giving thanks in everything, everything, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. I think that verse should be my mother's life verse. My mother is positively the most positive person I know. She is persistently grateful. She's 93 years old. She lives in an assisted living facility, and whenever I talk to her, she always reminds us how she is constantly praying over all of her children, her grandchildren, her great-grandchildren, and she's, no matter what difficulties she's had in her life, she continues to be persistently grateful. For instance, about a year and a half ago, she had a fall, and it was in a parking lot, and unfortunately, she wasn't able to catch herself from falling, and she fell forward and unfortunately broke her nose. She was rushed to the hospital, and my sisters were able to be there with her, and I couldn't make it there that night. So one of my sisters took her picture and sent it to me so I could see how banged up my mother was. And I called my sister, and I said, how is Mom doing? And she said, well, I'll put her on the phone. So she put my mom on the phone. Now, keep in mind, I know how banged up she looks. And I said, Mom, I'm so sorry that this happened. And she said, Marion, it could have been worse. She said, after all, I can still walk, I can still talk, I can still breathe. Now, not out of my nose right now, but I can still breathe, you know. So that's the kind of positive attitude and persistent gratefulness that I grew up catching. And, you know, as parents, we learn that with our children, often our values, our morals, what we have, how we live our lives is more often caught than it is taught. And some of you know that I'm a ventriloquist. In fact, one of the first questions I got when I arrived here this morning was, did you bring your puppet? And so when I was asked to speak, I thought, you know what, it would have been so much easier if they would have said, could you just bring a puppet, put a puppet on your arm, share a couple, you know, fun stories and an encouraging message. It would have been a whole lot easier, but to truly share how God is working and changing in my life is, you know, makes you feel a little bit more more vulnerable. And here's how I feel God is changing in my life. I have been struggling for a long time now with just really wondering, what does God want to do with me in my life? I have this desire to have a speaking ministry, but I'm not sure that that's where God is calling me. And, you know, perhaps you've had that experience too, where things are kind of doors open and everything seems to be lined up and you take a step forward and then things fall flat. That's how I feel has been happening to me. And even though I knew that the Holy Spirit could change me, I can't say that I truly was desperate for it. But this voice kept going around in my head, and it was a voice from a woman who had spoken to me many, many years ago. And she said, Marion, if you want to widen your ministry, you need to deepen it first. And I knew she was right. I knew that there was so much more. I mean, I was still going to church. I was still attending Bible studies and, you know, doing my little daily bread devotional every day. But I really felt like I was just skimming the surface, you know, kind of having these little spiritual snacks all the time. And yet knowing there was this depth that I just wasn't even allowing myself taking the time to discover it. Because you know what? I was busy. You know, a lot of us can say that. I work at our high school. I was a teacher for many years, and now I work at our high school. I do my ventriloquist programs at nights and weekends. I have my husband. We have four children, and I really found it very difficult to take the time to daily learn and read God's word and deepen that walk. Well, back in November, I bumped into a lady at the grocery store whom I hardly knew, and she asked me for my mailing address. And I thought it was kind of an odd request, but I gave her my mailing address. She said, Marion, I want to mail you a Bible. And so sure enough, within a few weeks, this Bible arrived at my house, and I looked at it, and it said, Daily Walk Bible, and I thought, oh, daily, that means daily, and I really was struggling with just that desire to even read the word daily, because I was busy. But then the pandemic hit, and right about that time, Pastor Gary encouraged all of us to daily, every morning prior to checking our phones, our emails, television, for us to be daily reading God's word and spending time in the word and in prayer. Well, I didn't have a job at school to go to anymore, and so I found myself with time, and I knew that I needed change and I wanted change. And so I accepted his challenge. And almost every day faithfully since the middle of March, I have been daily reading God's Word. And before I start, I begin by saying, God, please help me to know you more, help me to love you more, open my eyes so that I can see what you have to say to me. And I'm just going to sum it up in a few words. It has been revolutionizing to me. And on a whim, I looked up the word revolutionizing. And guess what? It means change, to change radically or fundamentally, but change. And now, I've only just read through the beginning of the Old Testament. I've got to about Job by now, but when I start reading about what God has to say and who he is, when I see how he led the Israelites in a cloud by day and a fire by night, I can be assured that when we have problems, God will give us provisions. And then when I skipped ahead and I looked in Isaiah 44, verses 6 to 7, God says, I am the first and I am the last. There is no God but me. Who, like me, can announce the future? Let him say so and make a case before me, since I have established an ancient people. Let these gods declare the coming things and what will take place. Do not be startled or afraid. Have I not told you and declared it long ago? You are my witnesses. Is there any God but me? There is no other rock. I do not know any. When I read that, I can't help but be amazed at God's sovereignty, his majesty. Who else can stand up against the power of our God? There is no one. There is no virus. There is no one who can stand up. He is our rock. And then when I read about his faithfulness, his love, his provision, his redemption in lives of people like Joseph and David and Ruth and Esther, I can just be filled with peace that there's redemptive hope for us as well. And then when I read about Ezra, who had the gracious hand of God upon him. Why? Because he devoted himself to reading, studying, obeying, and proclaiming the Word of God. And it just encourages me to do the same. And when I read about how the Israelites turned their backs on God and how they broke their covenants with him and they became stubborn, how there were consequences because our God is just and he is righteous. But then there were righteous people like Hezekiah who trusted in the Lord and God was with him. Here's the amazing thing. That same God in the Old Testament through faithfulness and faltering is the same God that it is alive and in our lives who is carrying out his purposes in our lives. Philippians 1:6 says, I am sure of this, that he who started a good work in you will carry it out onto completion until the day of Christ Jesus. So here's the change that I've seen. The more I am reading God's word, the more I'm learning. So the more I'm learning, the more I'm loving him. And the more I'm loving him, the more I can't help but raise my hands in worship of him. Several years ago, one of our daughters went out for cross country. Now that alone is remarkable because none of us are athletic type of people. But she decided that she can put one foot in front of the other, so she was going to go out for cross country. So we encouraged her to do that. And I went to her first meet, and I noticed at her first meet that she smiled the entire race. And other people came up to me and said, you know, did you notice she was smiling? And I said, yeah. So on the way home, I said, honey, I noticed during that entire race, you smiled. and she said, you know, Mom, I just didn't know if I was going to pass out or throw up, so I just kept on smiling. We know that as we get to know more about who God is and He reveals Himself to us, we know that we can trust Him no matter our circumstances. I don't know how God is going to open up doors for me. We don't know how this pandemic is going to impact all of our lives. But here's what we do know. We know that we have a God who keeps His promises, who is faithful, who loves us, and who is working out His purposes for our lives. And He is worthy of our praise. I desire the gracious hand of God upon me like Ezra. And I just want to encourage all of you, if like my mom, we can still say, but I can still breathe, then may we start committing ourselves and make that choice. Ask for God's Holy Spirit to transform us and make it an effort to daily walk with Him, to be like Ezra, reading, studying, obeying the Word of God. It will revolutionize our lives. Thank you.
Hi, church. So my name is Tyler Hers, and you may know me from sitting down here on the corner with my family or from Restore Community, which is a ministry that I'm involved with. And if you don't, my name's Tyler Hers. I'm married to Rachel, and we've got two beautiful boys. They are my stepsons, Hudson and Reese. And I was super excited when Gary gave us this opportunity to share our heart, because something that's really been pressed on my heart lately and is especially highlighted in the midst of this pandemic is the power of prayer. But before just jumping into that, I want to touch on intimacy and relationship with the Lord. Might preach a little bit here, because prayer is not to be reduced down to a required religious exercise. It's relational. Before we begin to truly acknowledge who we are in Christ, He starts to blossom our understanding of our adoption into sonship. And then as we believe that we are sons and daughters, we develop effective and fervent communication with the Creator of the universe. The Creator of the universe. That's why we can hear verses like 1 John 5:14 to 15 and regard it as true, as it says, "This is the confidence we have before Him. If we ask anything according to His will, He hears us. And if we know that He hears whatever we ask, we know that we have what we have asked of Him." That's the most beautiful and empowering thing. The God of the universe hears us. He hears you when you address Him. Whether you're in your prayer closet doing warfare, or you're sitting in the bathtub talking to Him, or if you're on your car on the way to work, He hears you. He hears you, period. In knowing our voice is heard, our prayer life can then develop past the point and mature past the point of begging and shameful confession into intimacy with the Father. If you take this back all the way to the beginning, into the garden, they communed with God. They walked with Him in the cool of the day. He talked with them and taught them about Himself, about His character, about His nature. It's almost as if God would just spend the day with these people, these new people, Adam and Eve, sharing the fullness of His beauty, the fullness of His splendor. And Adam and Eve are just like, wow, God, can you show me more? Can you tell us more? But as a people, we can tend to turn our time of intimate connection with God, with the Father, into just praying to get us through our day, or as a means of getting something or someone we want, or even as a means of venting without taking the time to let Him speak. Prayer is not begging God to do something He's reluctant to do or act upon. Prayer is rather declaring and enforcing Christ's victory over Satan. It's this beautiful partnership and communion with the child of God, us, with the Father, working hand in hand toward the realization of His redemptive and restoring purposes in the world, for His sake and for His glory, for His kingdom. See, our sovereign God has chosen from the time of creation to work through his children and not totally independent of them. He's configured this world so that much of what is truly his will, he makes contingent upon the attitudes and actions of human beings. So, church, I ask you to just ponder this for a moment. Reflect on it. How many promises of God have gone unfulfilled because of a lack of human involvement? You might think about that and think, wow, yeah, it's true. See, prayers can bring revival, healing, love, comfort, and change, all from the fullness of the Lord's splendor. Strongholds come down when and because we pray in the mighty name of Jesus. Our prayers have weight. They don't just go as a wisp in the wind or as a breath with possibility behind it. No, our prayers rise as incense to the throne of heaven. See, God is not only holy, he is love, and his love always desires to redeem, restore, and show mercy. On that, we ought to agree. Now, during this pandemic, prayer has undoubtedly been focused on the virus, our nation, our leaders, our church, etc., asking for protection, wisdom, and discernment over this new season, this new thing that God is bringing us into. But lest we not forget our prayers for the individuals around us, our brothers and sisters who need breakthrough in healing. We would normally be praying these things if a major pandemic wasn't on our radar. We can't forget about them. But we absolutely have to intercede for this nation and our leaders. We have to corporately unify in prayer. Please hear that. But we cannot forget to continue to pray over the individuals around us. Because those needs, those hurts, and those traumas, they don't go away in the midst of a greater corporate issue. And this is where I believe the Lord has been working on my heart the most during this season. He's been developing and changing my levels of compassion for people and the needs of people, but also my response. No longer do I wish to just give people my words as they express their struggle to me. Like, wow, man, that's crazy. I'm so sorry you're going through that. I hope it gets better. No, now I try to pray, though not always. I try to pray first, be it out loud, be it in my head for a moment, under my breath for a second, whatever. Because when you address the Father and invite him into a situation, hope becomes tangible. It becomes tangible. Now, it's something that I already knew, but there's a big difference between knowing something to be true and experiencing something true. And to kind of go along with that, I want to share this story that happened about a month ago, but it still continues to bear fruit. So a coworker of mine, a great friend and a great woman, she believes in God, but she lacks a real relationship with him or any application of such in her life. And about 2-3 years ago, she broke her ankle. It put her out for a while, but even now it still continues to cause issues. Anytime she would do any walking for an extended time or have a real physical exertion, the ankle would swell. It would balloon up. It would be extremely painful for her. She'd be out of work for at least a few days, and she'd have to wait until it got to the point that she could pull up a sock and be able to put a shoe on and then suffer through coming back to work maybe earlier than the healing, you know, would have allotted itself. And then we as teammates would see via social media her out enjoying life, enjoying her 6-year-old's childhood, and we think, well, let's just get ready to be short-staffed tomorrow because this was every time she did anything physical. Now, my friend, she also suffers from pretty severe anxiety. Anxiety over life, work, her children. And because she cannot go out and exert herself physically, her body image. About a month ago, it happened again. She went out to enjoy life, and it crippled her, as usual. Now, we muddled through about 2-3 days of work without her. And then finally, on the next day that she had come in, it was just her and I in the morning before the other associates came in for their shifts. And she started talking about the ankle thing. She started talking about the swelling, showing me pictures of the ballooned inflammation from days before. And then I felt so strongly in my spirit that the Lord was saying, son, why haven't you prayed for this? The truth in this conviction got me. I had to choke my tears back because God loves her so much. loves her so intensely, has value and compassion spoken over her life and her situation, but yet I allowed myself to feel inconvenienced by her affliction as opposed to declaring God's goodness over it. So I knew in my heart that I needed to. I tend to get a little anxious before praying, at least over someone who's unexpected. My heart starts to beat really fast, my hands get real sweaty, start, you know, like wiping my hands off like this. If you ever see me in a prayer meeting and you see that, you know something's coming. But I battled with that for a few minutes. It felt like hours, but it was a few minutes. And then another associate came in. I'm like, shoot, I missed my chance. I'm just gonna wait until lunch, which in itself was somewhat fearful. But anyways, she's in the lunchroom later, and I come in and real direct, I'm like, hey, listen, I've been battling with this feeling in my heart all morning, and I truly feel like I need to pray for you and your ankle. So can I please? You don't have to do anything, just receive it. Just receive a prayer. She obliged, and she even like threw her leg up on a chair next to her, and I just prayed. I said, Lord, I thank you for this woman. Jesus, I ask you to heal her ankle right now. Jesus, fully restored, 100%. In the name of Jesus, any spirits of affliction, anxiety, and fear, leave now, never to return. Never to return. Jesus, overwhelm her with your love and help her know what you say about her. In Jesus' name, amen. And she, you know, smiled as she wiped a tear. Amen, thank you. And I said, I'd go walk on it. And then I left. And that was it. That was it. But then about a week or so later, she pulls me aside, and you could tell there was something heavy on her. She said, Tyler, I just have to share this with you. Yesterday I was outside and went to the park, and I was running and chasing a ball and kicking a ball with my daughter. And look, no swelling. Tyler, there's no swelling. Thank you. She said, thank you. You healed my ankle. I said, no. Thank Jesus. Thank Jesus. He's healed you. It's really encouraging because over the last couple of weeks, she continues to come to me and tell me of all the physical activities she's doing, like hiking, walking, climbing rocks, all the stuff that she's doing. And she's like, look, no swelling. And we just look at each other, you know, we kind of giggle and we say, oh, thank God, so good. But there's even more fruit within this thing. Acts 3:16, and this is Peter addressing a crowd in whom is witnessing a man who was just healed, who couldn't walk. He says, by faith in his name, talking about Jesus, his name has made this man strong, whom you see and know. So faith that comes through him, Jesus, has given him perfect health in front of all of you. You see, there are seeds that God has sown through this thing. Put it this way. Here's who I work with. I work with the woman whom Jesus healed, a Jehovah Witness, the wife of a Jehovah Witness, a woman whom was born and raised Christian, but now is in love with a Muslim man and has no idea what she even believes. And the woman who was healed, her family, they have no relationship with God either. In fact, saying God bless you to their father gets yelled at. The name Jesus Christ is only invoked and announced out of deep frustration. But now these people get to witness her, watch her literally walking out, running out this testimony. Probably saying like, wait, wasn't your ankle? No. She can say, no, Jesus healed me. He healed me. And it's so beautiful. You might hear that and think, well, could be a coincidence, not totally sure. But I'm going to believe in faith that those seeds are sown deep in Jesus' name. I'm going to believe that the box that all these people have put Jesus in has shattered and that he's ministering to them. That even right now in this moment, he's meeting them and giving them exactly what they need in that moment. A great verse to just ponder and reflect upon, Isaiah 65:24. It says, even before they call, I will answer. While they are still speaking, I will hear. I thank God for those seeds sown, and I praise him that even before they know it, he's answering them, and he's answering you. My encouragement to you, church, is to be unceasing and persistent in prayer, relational with the Father, both corporately and on the individual basis, because he hears you. The Lord of heaven and earth knows your heart, and he is always prostrated towards you with compassion. I implore you to believe who he says you are and just talk to him. Just talk to him. Church, thanks for listening. Pastor Gary's going to come up and share a few words as well. Thank you so much. Love you.
Thank you again so much to Chris and to Marion and Tyler for sharing with us how God's been changing them. And if there's anything that you heard from all three of them, really, is this principle that we're actually going to be talking about for a number of weeks here, but just this idea that God never changes us just to change us. In other words, he changes us to help change others. And that's how it works. So we're going to go into a time of worship and just thankfulness and praising God for who he is. And God can change us as we worship as well. And that's the amazing thing of just when we're in his presence. Even if you're by yourself, his presence is with you. And we're going to be joining our hearts together. So just let me just pray over us as we enter into this time of worship. God, we thank you so, so much that you stepped down into a land of darkness. And you are our true light. The word says that we were wandering and walking in darkness. We dwelled in darkness, but we have seen a great light. And God, you did not just come down and make people who believe in you, but you came down and you changed us. You call us new creations. We are not who we used to be. And so we thank you for that. And Lord, our just natural response to that now is worship. And so we just wanted to spend this time in worshiping you. And thanks to you, God. And we lift high the name of Jesus Christ, the name above all other names, in honor and glory. In your name, amen, amen, amen. Let's worship God and lift his name high. Amen.
So good, Lord. We honor you this day. Great is thy faithfulness. Let's sing at the end.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not, thy compassions they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever will be.
Summer and winter.
Summer and winter, and springtime and harvest, sun, moon, and stars in their courses above. They join with all nature in manifold witness to thy great faithfulness, mercy, and love. Beginning to end, my life. That endures, thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide, strength for today and bright. tomorrow. Blessings all mine with 10,000 beside. Beginning to end, my life.
Church, I was struck by Psalm 33 this morning. I'm just going to read a part of it. For the word of the Lord is right and true. He is faithful in all he does. The Lord loves righteousness and justice, and the earth is full of his unfailing love. By the word of the Lord, the heavens were made, their starry hosts by the breath of his mouth. He gathers the waters of the sea into jars. He puts the deep into storehouses. Let all the earth fear the Lord. Let all the people of the world revere him. We wait in hope for the Lord. He is our help and our shield. In him, our hearts rejoice, for we trust in his holy name. May your unfailing love rest upon us, O Lord, even as we put our hope in you. Man, I love what that says. Walking around these walls, I thought by now they'd fall, but you have never failed me yet. Waiting for change to come, knowing the battle's won. For you have never failed me yet. Your promise, let's sing. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your hands, and this is my confidence. You've never failed me yet. Thank you, Jesus. I know the night won't last. Let's sing together.
I know the night won't last, 'cause your word will come to pass, and my heart will sing your praise again. Jesus, you're still enough. Keep me within your love. My heart will sing your praise again. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Sing it out. Your promise still.